Who are these people? Where are they? Where do they come from? Where do they live? Where do they work? What do they do? What are their homes like? How large are their families? What languages do they speak? What are their religions? What are their needs? Who are these people? How many of them are there? Sri Lanka is a rapidly growing and changing nation whose people are spread among its three major cities, Colombo, Kandy, and Jaffna, and hundreds of smaller towns and villages. These cities are representative not only of this island nation, but also of many developing countries, where the rapid growth of population is straining the capability of the government to provide basic goods and services. If the quality of people's lives is to be improved, careful planning is a necessity. Among the planner's most valuable tools is a census and the wealth of information it provides. The President of the Republic of Sri Lanka, J.R. Jayawardena.
The census was first inaugurated in 1871. Sri Lanka, therefore, among Asian nations, has a long history of demographic records. We are therefore fortunate for having basic demographic data of high quality for over a period of 100 years. In this context, it's not surprising that the distinguished demographer, Irene Tauber, referred to Sri Lanka as a veritable demographic laboratory. The government of Sri Lanka is by far the biggest user of census data. The broad and accurate census forms the base on which to keep our planning responsible to the needs of our people.
Listing of households is the first of the three stages of the carefully planned Sri Lanka census. After all housing units have been listed and a label applied to each for identification purposes, the larger task begins. During the second stage, a 10-day period called the preliminary enumeration, a census taker will visit each unit in his census block and record all required information. In the third stage, the census taker will retrace his steps in a single evening to make an accurate final count. The work of the census taker during the preliminary enumeration involves much more than merely knocking on doors. She seeks people out where they work or live, visiting fishing villages, rice paddies, timber yards, shops and dwellings of every sort. 10 days are required to complete the preliminary enumeration because most enumerators must conduct their census interviews at times that do not conflict with their permanent jobs. Questions asked on the census form go well beyond mere numbers. The Census Department also gathers information on the number of children who attend school, what types of jobs people have, how they get to those jobs, and pertinent information about living conditions. An entire section of the census form consists of questions about people's homes. In order to make the census accurate, the 70,000 census takers are well trained to obtain the required information. To accomplish this, the Census Department conducts a series of training classes well before the actual counting begins. Classes are held in the three major languages of Sri Lanka, Sinhalese, English, and Tamil, at locations in all parts of the country. These classes cover census-taking basics and also include questions and discussions to enable enumerators to become thoroughly familiar with the methods and goals of the census. UNICEF representative Mrs. Hoda Badran.
UNICEF is very much interested in the census that is taking place in Sri Lanka, because it gives us an idea about the situation of children in the country. For example, it tells us how many children in the school age are in school, how many are out of school. By repeating the census, it also gives us an idea whether the situation has changed to the better or the worse. And then finally, it also gives us an indication of what kind of action, what kind of programs would the government take to meet the problem, and what kind of input would UNICEF also have to assist the government.
The time is 9 o'clock. This is the Sri Lanka Broadcasting Corporation. The superintendent of census and statistics requests you to furnish details of your family and your household to the enumerator, who will call on you between now and the 10th of March. Your information will be treated as confidential.
Remote census blocks are large in area, but small in number of units to be counted. While urban census blocks might include up to 80 households, rural blocks are often no larger than 20 households. Throughout the period of the preliminary enumeration, it is stressed that the information gathered in the census will be used to help determine the future course of Sri Lanka. Enumerators are able to gain the confidence and trust of those whom they will interview. They must make people understand the purpose and benefits of the census and the uses to which the information will be put. Sri Lanka's experience has indicated that people are willing to cooperate because they know that census information collected will be held in confidence. Having been well publicized, the enumerator's visit becomes an important event in many households, often involving all family members. It is an unusual opportunity for people to feel that the government is taking an interest in them, their lives, and their needs. Thousands of tea plantation laborers live on Sri Lanka's tea estates. Both the preliminary and final enumeration are combined here into one interview, conducted by the estate superintendent, following his training by the Census Department. The final census count includes even the newborn in hospitals. This information is used by the Ministry of Health to identify areas in which people may need help in family planning and health care for their children. No one is ignored in the final count. Those in prison will be counted by prison officials, with assistance from enumerators, giving the government an accurate count of this often ignored segment of society. On the final census day, tourists are also counted in hotels and guest houses.
Even though I'm not from
Yes, that's right. We had found all the tourists also.
Guests are asked to fill out the special tourist form. Information gathered will help the government to determine where most tourists come from and where air transportation and promotional efforts should be increased. This information will help determine the need for additional tourist facilities and the large number of jobs they can provide. In the days following the preliminary enumeration, publicity about the final census is intensified. An increasing number of stories are printed about the upcoming final census count.
1981 population and housing census will be held tomorrow, the 17th of March. The final count.
Television, which reaches increasingly large numbers of people in Sri Lanka, and radio broadcast frequent notices. Announcements are made in the three major languages so that all will be able to understand.
Final count of the census. Today is 17th March. The superintendent of census and statistics requests you to be at home between the hours of 6 and 12 midnight until you have furnished details to the enumerator who will call on you. Your cooperation is solicited.
The final census day is declared a half holiday, with shops, offices, and factories closing at midday. By late afternoon of the final census day, streets are deserted as people return to their homes to be counted. The final census count begins in the early evening and continues until all households have been revisited. As the enumerator retraces his route from the preliminary count, he checks the information previously provided to ensure an accurate final count. The date selected for the final count precedes a full moon in a dry month, so that even in the most rural districts, where roads are poor and lights are few, enumerators can make the final count with a minimum of difficulty. In some areas, the final census count extends well into the early morning hours of the following day. People are asked to leave a lamp on in their homes until the enumerator has made his return visit. Only when all the lamps across Sri Lanka have been put out will the census be complete. UN Development Program Resident Representative, Mr. Y.Y. Kim.
The United Nations system on the whole has been associated with this 1981 Sri Lankan census right from the beginning. We found that for a modern and the scientific census taking, it would be useful to have the help of a highly developed computer, for instance. In addition to disk calculators, copying machine, typewriters, film mobile unit, and printing machines, and the training of programmers and demographic analysts, and the supply of two advisors to assist with data processing.
Deputy UN Fund for Population Activities Representative, Mrs. Elina Visuri.
United Nations Fund for Population Activities has also given a substantial support to the 1981 census program in Sri Lanka. Census results, as well as variable population statistics in general, are important for the planning and evaluating of population aid activities.
The information taken from the completed census forms is compiled into the final census report on population and housing. This report, the culmination of many months' work, is widely distributed throughout the various government ministries and to the members of parliament. As soon as the report is received, ministers and others responsible for planning and policy making begin to use this information to determine areas of greatest need. Statistics on the workforce will be available to the Ministry of Industries. Figures on school attendance and literacy will be used by planners in the Education Ministry. Statistics on movements of population and areas where additional land may be cultivated are of great interest to the Ministry of Agriculture. Sri Lanka's Parliament will use the information provided by the census as a basic reference work to help in determining priorities and enacting legislation to meet the country's needs. Census data is reviewed by representatives of United Nations agencies and other international groups at meetings with Sri Lankan government ministers and planners.
The idea of a census is to obtain accurate figures, not only of population, but of schools, other government institutions such as hospitals, and to help the government in its development plans.
As Sri Lanka's population continues to grow, the country is faced with the challenge of improving the quality of life of its people. Resources are limited, but needs are increasing. The census has shown that many skilled workers are coming to Colombo seeking employment, and that women are entering the workforce in ever-increasing numbers. It is vital that employment opportunities keep pace with this increasing demand for jobs. Census data has stressed that demand for housing in both urban and rural areas is very great. The need for increased availability of public health resources, including clinics to help mothers with family planning and child care, and training of medical personnel, is emphasized by the results of the census. The need for additional schools, colleges, and universities is underlined by the census. The Sri Lanka census does more than point out the country's needs. Its primary purpose is to indicate ways to fulfill these needs. The data from this census highlights the priorities and indicates where development programs should be concentrated. Sri Lanka's census represents one of the foremost efforts among Asian countries to gather information to be used for planning and policy making. Continuing its tradition of census taking is one of Sri Lanka's strongest investments in a better future for its people.